So the first topic is education. As we all know, education is a huge issue in Fermanagh. Budget cuts, closures, mergers, disagreement between schools, even our teachers intend to strike next Friday. In this morning's Impartial Reporter, we reported on job cuts at Devonish College and the news that a parent is seeking to take legal action against Education Minister John O'Dowd over his proposal to merge Patora Royal School and the Collegiate Grammar School. So question number one, is education in Fermanagh in crisis? Michelle Guillory.
Well, I don't think it's in crisis, certainly, but education is such a fundamental thing to all of us, and it's something we all cherish and value, and Sinn Féin believes that education is a basic and fundamental human right. Education should be free universally, available as of right, and there to assist everyone without exception to develop to their full potential. Sinn Féin want to see a system where equality of opportunity, access and provision is a basic requirement, where no parent is forced to pay for their child to obtain an education, and where the ability for learners to achieve that potential by having access to a range of subjects, to across the curriculum and the type of teaching that that is best fitted to deliver for that child. Now, it's obviously challenging to deliver. We've seen the issues that have happened across Fermanagh in the past number of years. It's obviously challenging when you have a situation where we have grammar schools who are creaming off the best of the P7 children, bringing them into one school. The other children are being educated, some in the town here, but others around the county. And I think the parents need to have the right, the access to, for example, if their choice is integrated, that needs to be available. If their choice is Irish medium, again, that needs to be available. But we also need to support schools in Rosslea, in Derry Lynn, in Brolla. I think we need, I don't want to see personally a situation developing where every child is taken from all arts and parts of Fermanagh and bussed into Enniskillen for an education, post-primary education. I think that's hugely counterproductive, and I think we need to take into consideration the size of the county, the spread of the population, and try and find a way that does that, that the child gets their chance to develop, but that they're also not under a huge amount of pressure, because we've seen far too much of that in recent years. We've seen the pressures on mental health, the pressures on exams. Young people are in a very difficult position at the minute, and we need a system that works for them.
There's lots of cuts in education, Michelle, as you know, and as the party that opposes all cuts, how do you and Education Minister John O'Dowd stand over those cuts?
Well, I think we have to look at how we deliver services best for the people of this area. And we don't oppose all cuts. Sometimes tough decisions have to be made, and we're in politics for decision making, and we do have to sometimes understand that. And I know in my own department, I was faced year on year with cuts to my department. I then had to choose what got cut and what got kept. And there were times my position was very different to that of my civil servants. So we recognise that there isn't an infinite budget. We recognise that there are challenges across the board. But we have to ensure that education, free education, is a basic right, that every child should be educated to their full potential, and done in a way where that child is whatever. We can't all be solicitors and accountants and the rest. We need every person to live up to their potential and to educate people for an economy here in Fermanagh. We've seen too many young people getting excellent results here and taking themselves off to Belfast, Dublin, or across the water for jobs. We have to educate people for the workforce and with skills that mean that they can get employment here in this county, they can stay here and make their lives and their homes here.
Tomala, you're very quick at times to blame Sinn Féin for the problems in education, but what has your party done to sort out schools in Fermanagh?
Well, thing number one, the question you asked initially, Rodney, was is education in Fermanagh in crisis? I think education actually throughout Northern Ireland is in a level of crisis and a degree of crisis. It's not just in Fermanagh, but obviously Fermanagh, where we are tonight, there is a very, very protracted situation. There are allegations and going towards the minister that he doesn't treat all sectors of the education system equally. We have seen areas and schools under pressure for some time, and other schools that haven't been under pressure either financially or numbers wise have been closed while others have remained open. Now, I've always taken the stance that I don't want to see any schools closed, particularly in rural areas. Now, I agree with Michelle on the position that why should they close a school at Balik whenever the next nearest school is maybe 20 miles away? I want to see those schools retained where possible. I come from an education background where I went to Duke of Westminster High School at Ballinamallard and Keish. They were both closed. I would have preferred to see them remain open, especially the Keish site that's much further from Enniskillen. But let's not forget, in the controlled sector, Listaski High School was closed last year, a school that should have remained open. Very, very difficult area for the community that it serves, and I would have loved to see that school retained, and I think it should have been retained. That is why there are the allegations that St Aidan's, St Eugene's and Brolla have all been kept open where they have serious financial difficulties, but still Listaski has been closed, and now the closure basically of Collegiate and Batora to merge into one school.
Are you for or against that proposal?
Well, I've always said, excuse me, I don't want to see any school close. I want to see where practical and possible.
Party divided on that issue?
Sorry?
Is your party divided on that particular issue?
Not that I'm aware of. The party view is we want to retain as many schools as possible. Members of the party may have views because they're on boards of governors or whatever, but that is their entitlement as an individual. I wouldn't want to deprive an individual member of any party of that right, of their privilege. But what I'm saying is I would like to see those schools, especially those successful schools, retained. If we could say one final thing, I sometimes think in Northern Ireland we have got a results-driven education system now. And when I say results, an academic results-driven education. Not everybody with the best will in the world can be doctors, can be teachers, can be nurses, can be solicitors. We also need people on the ground who are the nurses at the front line of services. We need the builders, we need the plumbers, and we need the electricians. So I would appeal to people that just because your child doesn't get 5A stars in A-levels, it doesn't mean they're a failure. I know most of the biggest businessmen in this county did not have a grammar school education.
John Coyle, is education in Fermanagh in crisis?
In my opinion, budgets have been slashed, you know, to the schools. You know, it's putting financial stress on the teachers, the Board of Governors, and then obviously it's going to affect the children. We have some brilliant schools. We have, you know, brilliant schools in Fermanagh South Tyrone, and they are providing first class education to them. I don't believe that they are in crisis. We need to make sure that every young person is entitled to a high quality education, whatever their academic achievement is. They may be, you know, high. I didn't go to a grammar school. I went to a high school in Brolla, and I came out what I was happy with, and I moved on. You can go into Southwest College and build yourself up to whatever level you need. It may take 2 or 3 years, but you will get to the achievement that you would like.
Up to 500 teaching jobs could be lost due to cuts in education, and you said there's no crisis.
Well, there is, like teachers, it is a crisis. If we lose those teachers, we are, you know, who's going to suffer? It is only the students. Classroom assistance budgets have been cut. These are the people that are helping, you know, the children that underachieve, for to bring them up to the best standard that they can. So those jobs should not be cut. There should be finances there for to make sure that they are there to help the children.
Tanya Jones, your view on this, please.
I think there is a crisis, maybe not an immediate dramatic one, but certainly a long-term crisis in that both financially and socially, the system that we have got isn't serving our children and young people to the best. The Green Party believe that education should be for the whole community, should be for life, and should be meeting all human needs, not just the narrow objective of getting a job. We believe that the ideal system for Northern Ireland would be a single publicly funded secular education system. We don't believe that it's right to be segregating young people according to their gender, according to their parents' religion, or according to how they did in an arbitrary test one day when they were 10 or 11.
And the Green Party would bring schools under local authority control, is that correct?
We would have a single system. It doesn't have to be a local authority, but there would be one system rather than the present dual system that
we have. Does that mean the likes of Fermanagh and Omagh District Council could run our schools? Is that your idea?
It could be, or it could be done via boards of education, or in a completely different way. We're not, we don't have any ideological baggage about what sort of structure it is, as long as it is universal.
And if the council took control of the schools, how would that work?
I assume it would work the way it works in most of England, where local authorities are in charge of schools, and they build up expertise in that area.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any questions? Yeah. We'll get a microphone.
From Enniskillen. I believe that Stormont has accepted that a post-primary school should have at least 500 pupils in order to develop the breadth of curriculum and the skills development to develop the full potential of each child. In that case, surely we all have to accept that schools do have to be a certain size to survive and to deliver the curriculum, the education that we need for the future of our economy, but also the future of each individual child and their full potential. Given that, and just taking a particular example and addressing this to Tom, given that Enniskillen High School was falling well below the number required, how did you feel about the possibility of the Enniskillen High School joining with Enniskillen High School, St Cole's Enniskillen, and providing the breadth of curriculum and skills development which would have benefited that area? And we
wouldn't
have had to close
Irish Green. Tom Elliott. Okay, thanks for that, Rosemary. On your first point, that's an arbitrary figure of 500 pupils. I don't ever recall that being approved at the Assembly at any stage. That's a figure that was brought out in a report of 500 pupils for post-primary sector and 100 for sixth form plus. And I think it was 105 pupils or something at primary school level. There are a large number of primary schools in Fermanagh that certainly doesn't have over 100 pupils. So that's an arbitrary figure that I think is being worked less to than it had been. It hasn't been approved. The issue around Enniskillen and how they could have worked with other schools, I have to say those discussions had commenced. Not only with St Cole's, but also with St Aidan's and Derrylin. There were discussions with the Enniskillen High School board and action group around that. I had been aware of some of them. I actually participated in at least one discussion around that. So I would have no difficulty around a proposal that may help to bring round the best education possible in an area that to suit the children and the needs of that area. So by and large, Rosemary, I would have no broad difficulty. Obviously, there would be huge issues around the control and governance of it. I would like to see a single education system in the long term and in the long run, but we're probably a long way off that at the moment, unfortunately. But again, I would have supported those discussions. We even appealed to the minister before he made his decision to close Enniskillen. A group of us met with him and appealed to allow those discussions to develop, but he didn't allow them.
Any other questions?
Yep. Matthew Murphy, Enniskillen, St Michael's College. This is particularly directed at Tania, but also all of you. Does an integrated education system mean a secular education system?
It doesn't have to mean a secular education system. Most of the integrated schools at the moment have a specific Christian ethos. But as our society opens out, we have more people from different religions and from no religion. I think it's appropriate for schools themselves to be secular and for there to be provision for children and young people to obtain a greater understanding of their own faith within a social context outside the school system.
Michelle?
Thanks for the question, Matthew. To be honest, I think people wouldn't choose that at the minute. And we have to give people choice. We have to give people the ability to choose. But we also have to look at the challenges that we have. So I think a very pragmatic example is the work that Fermanagh Trust are doing here in this county about bringing schools together, about sharing facilities, sharing teachers, etc. In fact, it sort of leads into Rosemary's question, because I feel that there's very exciting models that we can use to get a figure that children have an overall range of subjects and the social opportunities, etc., that you'd like to see in a post-primary school, but that it doesn't have to be one building with 500 pupils. It could be a collegiate kind of example, like St Aidan's, Lissaski and St Eugene's, or it could be Brolla, who are looking across the border and developing linkages across the border to ensure that there are enough students. At the minute, most people choose to go down the Christian-based education route. I know I'm old enough to remember schools like the Christian Brothers in Armagh, and the fact that if it wasn't the Catholic Church, and we can say a whole lot about the Catholic Church, and it's not all good, but they really did instill a value in education that I think has stood a lot of us in good stead. And we wouldn't have seen a generation ago people getting the education that they did. And education is the best route out of poverty. But I don't know, if people were to choose a secular-based system now, I would imagine that while people might say in a forum like this, yeah, that'd be a great idea, when it comes to actually making a decision and sending your child, or your child choosing to go somewhere, they'll choose to go down the lines that they have done in the past.
Okay, we're going to do our last 5 minutes on this particular topic, so we're going to go over, and Sean Paul has got some tweets.
Yeah.
Robert's got some
tweets. I've got some tweets.
Very exciting.
Sean Paul and myself will be monitoring the tweets throughout the night. So if anyone has Twitter, please feel free. So just to say, just looking through some of the tweets, a lot of young people want to know, I think most people will agree that some kind of reforms need to be made in the education system here, that it's failing a lot of our young people. And in each of your party's proposals, what part do you propose young people will play in those reforms, and what part will young people play in changing the education system and making it work for them?
John Coyle first, please.
Well, the children in Fermanagh South Tyrone Lake have great initiative. They are, they have their own minds. They know what they want to achieve. And, as I said before, if it takes a year or two extra for to get where they can, they will achieve what they have set out for themselves. We have great expertise here in the county, from building and joinery to solicitors and lawyers, etc., lawyers and barristers. But the children, if they have their heart set on it, we are here to provide the best education for them to achieve that.
John Malia?
I think what we need to do is have a partnership approach. You need to take the views of young people and also feed that into a system that we have, whether that's at the Assembly or at the education boards, which will now be one board. So I think it is important that you take the young people's views. Obviously, they're not going to have the final say, but quite often what we don't do is give them any say at all. And I think that's where we need to take on view or on board their views. What we need to do, though, is set up some sort of panel around that, because quite often what happens is you will get a whole range of different views fed in and they'll all be ignored. So I think it needs to be streamlined, focused, and a partnership approach. That's our view towards including the young people within the education system and the education decision making.
Tanya?
I think young people are excluded from political debate to a great extent at present. It's something of a vicious circle. Young people tend not to vote, and so they tend their interests tend not to be represented by the parties, and hence they become more disenfranchised. I'm very pleased to see Rock the Vote and all their work, such as this evening. I think that the inclusion of 16-year-olds in the franchise for the Scottish referendum was a great step forward. It showed that young people have the maturity, have the thoughtfulness to be able to use their vote at 16, and there are also many practical advantages of encouraging people to vote at 16 when they're likely to be living at home at a stable address. They could get into the habit of voting before they move on to university. The Green Party is, of course, very strong among young people, particularly students across the UK, and we recognise the ways in which young people are being discriminated against at the moment, particularly with the huge level of tuition fees and of student debt. And our position is that third level education should be free, and that there shouldn't be tuition fees.
Okay, and finally, Michelle, you'd obviously agree with Tanya's point about lowering the voting age to 16?
Absolutely, that's been Sinn Féin policy now for well over a decade, and I believe it's fundamental. Young people do have to be taken into consideration. I would say if you were to ask, the two of the things that young people have the most problem with at the minute is the fact that we do have a very results-driven system here, and I know a lot of young people value the extracurricular, the sporting achievements and all. School is about more than results, and it's about developing your skills in whatever way they are. They also wouldn't be happy about the British Tory Party policy in reducing our budget year on year, and the fact that there's less money to spend in our schools and in education, and they'd feel very disenfranchised by that as well. I suppose one of the best examples in recent times of young people's ability to make their voices heard was the great DVD that the Collegiate put together, and unfortunately didn't seem to be taken into consideration. So there was a school and a group of girls who really were committed and dedicated to their school, and you know, it wasn't taken into consideration. So I do believe that young people absolutely have to have their views need to be heard, they need to be listened to, and they need to be taken into consideration, because these are the people that were, it's a real cliche and I hate it, but they're the leaders of tomorrow, and we need them to stay here to create a society that we can all be proud of and to make Fermanagh a better place.